Hello viewers, today we begin with the parts of a flower. Flower has four whorls or four floral whorls. They are calyx, corolla, androecium and gynoecium. Then the first and foremost, that is the calyx. It is the outermost whorl of the flower. It is composed of sepals, or you can say the sepals collectively are called as calyx. Generally sepals are green and they are leaf like structures. They protect the other floral organs in the bud condition. After the fertilization, sepals wither away, but in certain plants like brinjal, the calyx is persisting. So the calyx can also be described as gamosepals or polysepals. When the sepals are fused together, they are called as gamosepals. And when the sepals are free from one another, the calyx is termed as polysepals. Now we move on to the corolla. Petals are collectively called as corolla. Or corolla, it is composed of petals. Generally petals are bright in color. Because they have to attract the insects for the process of pollination. So here on the screen you can see the parts of the flower: calyx, corolla, gynoecium and androecium. Now again, the corolla, if the petals are united, the corolla is gamopetalous, and if the petals are free, the corolla is termed as polypetalous. So I told you, generally they are bright in color because they have to attract the insects for the process of pollination. Now we move on to the next topic, that is estivation. The mode of arrangement of sepals or petals with respect to the other members of the same whorl is termed as estivation, or you can say the arrangement of sepals or petals in relation to one another in the bud condition, it is termed as estivation. The following estivations you see on the screen here, they are the many types of estivation are there. They are, the first one is the velvate, twistate, imbricate and vexillary. So this way the arrangement of sepals or petals in relation to one another in the bud condition is called as estivation. The first one, that is the velvate estivation. In this type, the margins of the sepals or petals in the whorl, they touch one another and there is no overlapping. That is, the margins of the sepals and the petals just touch one another and there is no overlapping. Example, calotropis or the many other, you can see here on the screen the types of estivation. This first one is the velvate. Here this is the velvate estivation A, and it is seen in calotropis. Another is twisted. In this twisted type, one margin of the appendages overlap that of the next one and so on. This you can easily see in China rose, lady's finger, cotton, etc. Once again, here one margin of the sepal petal overlaps the margin of the next sepal or petal, and one margin is overlapped, is inner two. Overlap means it is inner two by the margin of another segment. Example, I told you, hibiscus or China rose. Then the third one is the imbricate. In the imbricate type, when the margins of the sepals or petals overlap one another but not in any particular direction, they are not in any particular direction. That means here the odd sepal or petal means posterior. Odd sepal or petal means the posterior sepal or petal. It is completely internal with both its margins being overlapped, and one sepal or petal is completely external and overlaps the margin of its adjacent segments. The other three members have one margin overlap and one margin overlapping the next segment, as in twisted aestivation. I repeat, one sepal petal is completely external and overlaps the margin of its external adjacent segments, and the other three members have one margin overlap and one margin overlapping the next segment, as in twisted aestivation. And the odd sepal or petal, which is posterior, it is completely internal with both its margin being overlapped. This you can easily see in the corolla of Cassia and Gulmohar. Corolla of the Cassia and Gulmohar. Now we move on to the next type, that is vexillary. Vexillary, it is also termed as papilionaceous. That means it is the important characteristic feature of papilionaceae family members. So vexillary, it is also termed as papilionaceous. In this type there are five petals. The largest one, which is called a standard one, overlaps the two lateral petals. The two lateral petals, they are termed as wings. They are termed as wings, which in turn overlap these two smallest anterior petals, which are termed as keel. This you can see in peas and beans. So once again, generally vexillary, it is also termed as descendingly imbricate. It is found in papilionaceous corolla, the posterior vexillum or standard petal. It is completely external and overlap the two wing petals. Two wing petals means two lateral petals, which in turn overlap the two smallest anterior petals. These anterior petals are termed as keel. So these are internal, that is one of the margin of the each of the wing petal overlaps one of the margins of the keel petals. Therefore they show internal arrangement, and therefore you can easily see this vexillary type in the or the posterior vexillum or the standard petal along with the wings and the keel, easily seen in peas and beans. Next we move on to the androecium. Androecium, it is the male part of the flower. It is a male reproductive whorl of the flower. It is composed of one or more stamens. It is composed of one or more stamens, and each stamen consists of a stalk or filament. Each stamen consists of a stalk or filament, and on top it is the anther. You can see here the structure of androecium on the screen, and each anther is bilobed. Each anther is bilobed, and the each lobe has two chambers or pollen sac in which the pollen grain are produced. Then the one of the term is there, that is staminode. So the sterile stamen, it is not able to produce pollen grains, therefore it is called a staminode. I repeat, a sterile stamen which is not able to produce pollen grains, it is called as staminode. Then another condition also you find in the stamens, that is, if the stamens are attached to the petals, they are called as epipetalous. They are called as epipetalous. I repeat, if the stamens are attached to the petals, they are called as epipetalous. Example in brinjal or the Solanaceae members, you can easily see epipetalous condition in the Datura also. And if they are attached to the perianth or tepals, that is in the Liliaceae members. So if the stamens are attached to the perianth or the tepals, they are called as epiphyllous. They are called as epiphyllous or epitapylous. Example in lily. Then when the stamens remain free from one another and also from other floral whorls, they are called as polyandrous. They are called as polyandrous. I repeat, when the stamens remain free from one another and also from other floral whorls, they are called as polyandrous or united to a varying degrees. Based on the union cohesion, the stamens or stamen androecium may be of following types, that is monadelphous, diadelphous and polyadelphous. In the monoadelphous situation, all stamens are united into a one bunch or bundle, into a one bunch or bundle. Example, China rose. In the diadelphous situation, the stamens are fused into two bundles. Example, pea or beans. And in polyadelphous condition, the stamens are fused into more than two bundles. Example, citrus. So there may be variation in the length of the filaments within a flower. Example, salvia, mustard. This way I explained you the monoadelphous, diadelphous and the polyadelphous condition of the stamens.